Yeah, currently live on YouTube. And okay. So yeah, welcome to Hacker Tools, Web and Browsers and Security and Privacy. So I'm Hawei. And I'll be probably be doing this week's Hacker Tools as well as next week's Hacker Tools and possibly the one on LaTeX as well. Not sure yet, but most likely. Yeah, so we are live on YouTube as well if you prefer to join by YouTube. Although no one is monitoring the comments there, or rather chat there. So if you're in here, then you get to ask questions. If you're there, no one is monitoring the chat there. So yeah, okay. The link for the slides, give me a second. This is a link to the slides, so you can follow along. There isn't much in the slides because most of the content is like me demoing different software and talking about different like the different workflows or different choices and different principles that you might think or different things that you might consider when you are choosing your own workflow and things like that. Okay. Everyone got the slides? Yes? Okay, let's go on. Okay, so brief overview, which actually is basically what is in the title. Today we're gonna talk about ways you can improve your web browsing experience. And then we talk about security and privacy online as well as offline, right? Yeah. And then all the things that go into that. So first section is browsers in the web. Yeah, so like how you can customize your browser and tips and tricks about browsers and web browsing and navigating the web and things like that. Yes. Okay. So we start off with the very basics, which is keyboard shortcuts, of course. So most of these are sort of standard across the browsers. Okay, these are the few standard ones. I think once you go on to the more esoteric ones, they will start to diverge between browsers. So okay, this is the, so I'm sure everyone knows about like things like Control T for new tab, right? As well as Control Shift T. So I just close a new tab. So if I want to reopen that tab, I need to actually go to a website. So go to Google, right? And if I now close this tab and I want to reopen it, I can press Control Shift T and it should reopen the tab, right? This also applies to new windows, so at least on Firefox. So if I press Control N gives me a new window, right? And if I go to like Google on it or GitHub, now I close this window, or I want my window back, I can press Control Shift N and it will reopen my window. So if I close the whole window with multiple tabs, then I can press Control Shift N and it will restore the entire window with all the tabs, which is useful, especially if you're doing like online exams, right? And then you have your normal tabs open and then you have to close it for exams. You can just close the window and then after an exam, press Control Shift N to restore that window. Assuming that it is still persisted in your browser's history, because if you reset the browser, then it may be lost. Yeah. Then there are shortcuts like Control Tab or Control Shift Tab to change tab, right? So I'm pressing Control Tab now, so it'll just alternate between all my tabs. So this is like alternate tab, right? Except it's for the browser tab, so it's Control Tab. And if you press Shift, then you alternate in the reverse direction, right? there's a shortcut to jump to your address bar, so I like to use F6. Basically, F6 jumps to the address bar, so you can type in a new address immediately. Or nowadays it's an omni bar, right? So like you press F6, you can sort of jump to the address bar / search bar, and just key in a search query or whatever you want, right? I believe alternate D. I forgot to explain. So what does this mean? This capital C means control, this capital M means alternate or meta, and this is F6 layer. So if I say CMI, that means control alternate I. Yeah. So again, alternate D here means jump to address bar, as well as F6, and control L as well. They all do the same thing. I'm sure you know about control F, which is to search in a page, right? But in Firefox, there is this quick search. Oops. Let me go to GitHub. Yes, okay. So there are a lot of pages that, if you go to a page that doesn't handle / specially, so like Google, for example. So if I press / the / key, right, you can see it actually opens up this quick find. Right, so I can say hello, and it's basically like fine lah. It's just it just goes away. It's slightly more quick. The / is kind of like the / in like a Vim or like a less. Yeah. Yes. And we have Control W, which is to close the tab, right? And then we can reopen the tab. And then we can control W to close it again. We have control F4, which is also to close a tab, right? Alternate F4 closes the window, usually, depending on if you're on Windows, it does that. I'm not sure if it does that on Mac. And you can middle click the tab to as well close the tab, right? And finally, F12 is the key to pull up the developer tools. So we'll touch more on the developer tools later on, but these are some of the keyboard shortcuts. I think these are the most commonly used ones. There are of course a lot more, like depending on what kind of browser add-ons you have, right, that you may use. So you can look here for like more keyboard shortcuts. There are a lot more keyboard shortcuts, but again, these are the common ones. Okay, so that's our first slide. Okay. Next thing. So I think in the past when we had Google, in the past Google used to interpret search queries more literally, right? Nowadays, like whatever search query you key in, right, which I'm going to use incognito. Okay. So I'm going to use empty. So like normally, okay, so whatever search query you key in nowadays, right? How to say, for example, if I key in a search query, something like I say hello, right? Google will actually give me results that are most of the results will have the word hello in there, but it's Google isn't searching for things that have the word hello. It's searching for things related to the word, to your query. So if you enter in a more complex query, for example, let me think. Okay, random. Random search query here. You may eventually find, it really depends on the query, but sometimes you may find let's see. Yeah, so eventually you may find a result that, let's say you're asking for green chicken curry. You may find results that don't actually have chicken, like say this one, okay, this one mentions chicken here. This one doesn't seem to mention chicken, right? So like, Google isn't actually looking for all the words in your query. It's just searching for things that things are relevant based on your entire query. So sometimes you don't want this behavior. You want literally green chicken curry, right? So what you can do is to just put the keyword that you are looking for in quotes, right? And this will tell Google that you really want those three particular words, or you know, whatever you have in quotes, right? In the search, so that, you know, so any results that don't have in this case green chicken curry will not be included, as in Google will not show you those results. So it must, the particular page must have green chicken curry in order for it to be shown. So why is this showing here? Because it actually talks with chicken here. So if you quote it, it means that it must appear, and must appear exactly like that. Yeah, so if you ever, you know, if you have a search query where for some reason Google, like, you normally it shows up when you have more complicated searches. So like when you have more complicated searches and, you know, Google doesn't show you results that meet all the sort of adjectives they are looking for or something like that, right? That's when the quotes can come in useful. Does quote mean that it must show in the order or all those words in any order? So in the past, at least as far as I know, it means it has to show up in the order. But I think Google is getting more loose and not more loose, but they're trying to get smarter with the way they pass queries. So it may no longer need to be all those words in the same order anymore. I think if your entire query is just like that, like one quoted phrase, then it will make sure to show, it will only include pages that have that exact quoted phrase. But if you have other words in the search, then you know, then all the heuristics will start to kick in again. Yeah. Yeah. So yeah, it really helps nowadays. Okay. Another useful operator is the side operator. So like let's say, okay, so I don't know if you use Reddit, you might know that Reddit search engine kind of sucks, right? So if you ever want to search for something on Reddit in particular, and you know, sometimes it's useful because there is a lot of useful advice on Reddit, for example, especially like technical stuff, then you can use the site operator. So let's say I'm looking for, I don't know, like something like that. Yeah. So if I want to search for Redditors' opinions, Singapore Redditors' opinions on ramen, then I can look in the Singapore subreddit for best ramen, right? And so this is the site operator. So you can specify just a domain, you can specify a path within the domain and so on. And you can search within that particular, yeah, whatever you specify. Can you specify multiple domains? I believe. Maybe you can, so like maybe not. Well, there's no results on there's no vote.co results that are coming up, so maybe not. I think the all is the, okay, maybe there simply isn't anything about on vote. .co, yeah, okay, that's why. Did I get the domain wrong? Yeah, okay, so all work. Yeah, Quora, what's the domain for Quora? Quora.com? Yes. Yeah, but there's nothing coming up on there's nothing coming up from Quora. But okay, just now when I had bbc.com, yeah, you see BBC did come up. So yes, it seems like you can search, so you can use the OR operator. Yeah. And if I remove the or, it seems to, you get no results because it's taking it as a conjunction or an and. Right? Yeah. So you can search for salt sites from multiple, but like any of the domains that you specify, right? Yeah. Another useful operator is the file type operator. So if you're looking for a PDF of, let's say you want to look for a PDF of an ebook or something like that, you can just search file type. PDF and then like I don't know, yes, thing like that, and there you go. You get a all the results will be PDFs of whatever you're looking for, right? Or if you want like talk, yes, there we go. We have PDF on talk, right? So if you attended our data wrangling workshop, then you will know what these tools are. Yeah, so this is useful. It will work with anything, although it will work with anything that Google can index. So like, I don't think you'll get anything if you search for zip, because Google can't really search for zip. You cannot really search for special characters. Like if you're looking for exclamation mark, the best, I think if you want to use Google, your best bet is to just spell it out. So like, Python, let's see. Yeah. What does then? Yeah, your best bet is to use is to spell out the actual name of the character. If you do this, most of the time, you don't get anything useful, right? Because special characters are not significant to Google. There is another search engine called SymbolHound. Right, which is sensitive to special characters. You can use this search engine. Yeah, but this search engine is not as good as Google, of course. What I will do is spell it out. Yes, if. It's not great, but unfortunately, special characters are not significant to Google. So, the best you can do is to spell it out, and hopefully, you get useful results. Or you can try SymbolHound, but SymbolHound is nowhere near as good as Google search. So, okay. And lastly, we have define tool. So let's say define, let's just define bash, right? So Google nowadays has these panels that appear. So like, it's quite convenient. Like if you want to like just search for a definition of a word, you can just say define colon, whatever it is. And then if Google has an answer for you, then you will get the answer. Tell you a lot of things, so like synonyms, what the different tenses, what's the different meanings, what's the different etymologies, and so on and so on and so forth. And even you can even look at the n-gram. And they even have I found it out like quite recently, like you can have now they even have pronunciation, so you can ask for a pronunciation of something, and then you can even select like okay, for some reason, I am using a different user for this browser, so can't hear the sound. But you can choose like it will even tell you the different pronunciation for British / American. Yeah, you can also use Google Translate, I guess. Yeah, I mean you can use all the other websites, but now Google helps. Google has all of these things, so if you don't mind giving all of this data to Google, then you can use it. You can use all these things that Google provides you, right? Yes. So these are Google search operators. Like other search engines, such as DuckDuckGo, will have their own, and maybe they are similar, maybe they're not. I'm covering Google because it's the most common search engine, right? Although, yeah, I know that the other half of the talk is on privacy, so that's when I'll talk about DuckDuckGo. Yeah, yeah, the first half is on web. So we talk about the web first, and then we talk about privacy, right? So if you look, if you want to look for more, if you want to look for more operators, you can look at Google's own documentation, which is quite limited. Google seems to have a lot more operators than are actually documented by themselves. So yeah, you can look at these two websites. Right, let's move on. Okay, now we get to, so that was, we talked about browser keyboard shortcuts. We talked about using Google more effectively. Now let's talk about certain things you can do with your browser. So where is my library? Oh. So let me just, yeah. So Firefox has this, what do you call it? Firefox has this thing called a keyword bookmark, or bookmark keyword, sorry. So basically, if you open up any, if you open up any, what do you call it, bookmark in the, if you open up any bookmark in Firefox, sorry, right, you, yeah, you see down here, there is a, what do you call that? So you have this keyword field, right? So what does this keyword field do? Basically, if you fill in a keyword here, for example, this is my keyword for my email, right? Or let's look at something else. So the example I used was the Rust documentation, right? So if you fill in a keyword here, then okay, let's look at let's look at a simple one first. So yeah, okay, my email. Okay, let's use my NUS email. So if I fill in a keyword here, just NUSM, right? Then now when I want to open my NUS mail, I just press NUSM, and I can it will go to my NUS mail, right? But there is something more powerful that you can do with the keyword bookmarks, is that basically you can put in a %s in the URL. If you can see this %s, right? And basically you can key, you can type in stuff after the keyword in the URL bar, and it'll replace the %s with whatever you key in. So I have a few %s shortcuts, like this one goes to the Arch manual pages, this one goes to Wiktionary, this one goes to Elixir documentation, this one goes to the Rust documentation. So if I want to look in the Rust documentation for like option, for example, then I just type rsdoc option, and it'll bring me straight to the it'll bring me straight to the search page with the keyword filled in option. I mean the search query filled in lah. And yeah, so I also have like one for like the Arch manual pages. So like if I'm looking for a manual page for, let's say, I don't know, what's this called, is there? I'm looking for kill in the manual section 2. Then I can just type again, amen, that's my keyword. And then I can type kill.2, right? And it'll bring up the kill 2 manual page, right? Yes. So how do you do this? You just go to your, you just create a bookmark as usual, right? Okay, let's just use this example. So I created a new bookmark. I'm going to put it into my, I categorize it under the keywords folder, but you can do it, you can put it wherever you want, it will still be recognized, right? So I create a new bookmark, put it under the keywords folder. Then I need to go to my bookmarks and open up the bookmark again, and then I can key in a keyword here. Let's say amen. Right. And then I just need to replace the part of the URL that I want to be replaced by my query with %s, you know, which is like the C printf format specifier, right? So now, and yeah, you might want to just rename this so that it's not, you might want to rename it so it's not specific to the particular page. Right. And then I can now type my keyword followed by the query, and then it will replace, it will just work. Yeah. So, can you have multiple %s's? I don't think so. We can give it a try. So, let me just modify. What happens if I have multiple percent S's? Yeah, it doesn't work. Oops. Oh, okay, it works. Okay, so if you have multiple percent S's, you'll just replace each occurrence of percent S with your query. So I feel like that's not very useful, but yeah. What is the microphone I'm using? I am using a... I'm using a Samsung Q2U. It costs $60 on Taobao. I would say it was worth it because I also TA, so like I believe sound quality does matter a lot when you're giving a workshop, right? Or teaching. So I think it was a worthy investment. I mean, it wasn't like super expensive. It's not cheap, like $60, but it's still a relatively cheap microphone for and quite good quality for the price. If you don't buy it off Taobao, you might find it slightly more expensive, maybe $80. Yeah. I'm honestly not sure why it's on Taobao because it's not a Chinese brand. Yeah. How does New York Times, for example, know that you have access to more than 3 articles? Cookies, basically. If you clear your cookies, and possibly local session, session storage, and possibly to track your IP as well. So, try opening incognito. If they still track you, that means they're tracking your IP. Yeah. Anyway, I will mention later on, there's one add-on that you can use to try to bypass these paywalls. Yeah, okay. Anyway, back to my planned slides. So, So these are big bookmark keywords. They only exist in Firefox, right? I'll show you an example, or not example, but alternative for Chrome. So in Chrome, you can have this thing called a custom search engine, right? So if you just go to settings and you click on manage search engines, right? Then you can you can create your own search engine, right? And then you can do the same thing, lah. So let's say I want to look for my, I want to have my Rust documentation search engine. So Rust, and here again, you can have a keyword and a URL with percent S in place of query, right? So I can just do that. So now I have my Rust documentation search engine. So, So I just need to type rsdoc, right? And then I type space or type tab, and then it will switch to that search engine. So I can then again. So yeah, you can sort of use it in Chrome as well. In Chrome it's like a custom search engine, and you can't really have like a keyword bookmark. You know, so like my other bookmarks, like just to access my different, you know, the sites that I access often, right? I can have keywords for those, right? You can't really do that in Chrome. Although in Chrome, as well as Firefox, whatever bookmarks you have, if you just type it in the omnibar here, usually it'll show up. But, you know, you have to rely on sort of the heuristic matching, right? Instead of just having a keyword that works all the time. So that is custom search engines in Chromium, right? I believe you can actually do the same in Firefox, but in Firefox you have the keyword bookmark, so there's actually no need to do that, lah. Okay, yeah. Yes, in Firefox you have this thing called a container tab, right? So, basically, if you long press this here, then you have a number. You can create a number of containers, right? And what the containers are basically is like it has a separate set of cookies and local storage and stuff. So like you can log into multiple accounts, and like it will just behave as if they are separate, they're independent sessions, lah. So like if whatever website you're visiting doesn't support multiple logins, right? Then you can just create a new container and log into multiple accounts at the same time, right? So, So like here I have number of accounts. So I have one container for Taobao because I don't want Taobao. I don't trust them to keep my data. I just don't trust them. And I have one for like the NUS hackers domain accounts. I have one for my alternate GitHub account, and I have one for this is one of the organizations in NUS, right? So like it also helps you to like separate, like if you want to sort of segregate your personal and maybe like school stuff or whatever it is, right? Then you can use a container to do that. Do container tabs work in incognito? No, it doesn't make sense because incognito is like a separate incognito works like a separate temporary container. Sort of like it's not exactly the same because in incognito certain things are just don't work at all. For example, the local storage, or is it session storage, I believe. In incognito, the IndexedDB, which is a form of local storage, like is totally disabled. Yeah, it's good to be in permanent incognito la, in terms of privacy, but then you lose out a lot of, you have to keep logging in everywhere, la, which is very inconvenient. So like, you know, I guess a decent compromise is to use those privacy plugins, which we will talk about in a bit. Yeah. Okay. So in Firefox, you have container tabs. And in Chrome, you have, or Chromium, you have profiles, right? Profiles are not as lightweight as container tabs, right? Because profiles are like, Firefox has profiles as well, right? But when you create a new browser profile, it's basically an entire copy of, or entire new like profile, right? So it has all the browser settings, all your add-ons and stuff are not shared between profiles, right? So container tabs are slightly, I think, more convenient. If you are like a single person using a browser, you just want to segregate certain websites. But in Chromium, you sort of have you can use different profiles la, and sort of achieve the same thing, but it's just slightly more inconvenient because like between profiles, all your plugins, all your settings are not shared, right? But those are the things that you want to be shared. It's just cookies and you know the session that you want to be separated between containers, right? So yeah, but you know you can just add a new profile and then you can log into different accounts as well. Right. So that's Chromium profiles and Firefox container tabs. Yeah. Okay. Some tweaks you can do in Firefox. This only applies to Firefox. Chromium does not let you do any of this. So these are some of the, what do you call that? These are some tweaks that I like to apply on my browser, right? So basically, how do you apply this? You go to about config, right? You go to about config, and then you may get the warranty screen, right? In fact, let me just open up a new Firefox profile. And, So we have a new Firefox profile here, and if I go to about config, then you get this warranty screen, right? And you can just untick it and then accept the risk. So I like to apply these changes, right? So what do these do? This one, the first thing, the first one is disabling select events. Sorry, select events. So like there are some websites that are, I don't know why, but they use JavaScript to prevent you from highlighting text. Because they don't want you to copy, so it's kind of useless and annoying. So you can just disable those events, right? That means like those JavaScript events won't be fired, la, so like they can't do any. So the website can't intercept your highlighting or whatever, right? You can also disable the clipboard events. So there are some websites that try to stop you from copying and pasting, which is also futile, but honestly, they try, right? So you can just disable those as well if you want. There are also websites that sort of override the context menu. So like, for example, in Google Drive, You see, when I right click here, I get the Google Drive context menu, right, instead of my browser context menu. But sometimes I want my browser context menu. So in Firefox, one way you can do it is to disable, just entirely disable the context menu event so that browsers cannot override the context menu. But actually in Firefox, you can just override it by shift right clicking, right? So if I don't shift right click, I get the normal context menu. This is with the option enabled, so that the sites can still override the context menu, right? So if I normal right click, it will just show the site's context menu. If in this case Google Drive, if I shift right click, then I will bypass the website's context menu and I get the browser's context menu. So for whatever reason, I need to access something from my browser context menu, I can. I believe this does not exist in Chrome. So let's look at Chrome. What is a website that has a context menu that I don't have to log into? If this website has a custom context menu. And it's not loading. Yeah. This browser has no extensions installed, so it's kind of you see all the advertisements. Yeah, I can't really try it because I don't have a website that doesn't have I know has a context menu. And I do not intend to log into Google on Chromium here, so you can give it a try, but as far as I know, it doesn't exist. Like this shift right click feature doesn't exist in Chrome, it only exists in Firefox. Where are these settings in Chrome? You mean these settings? These settings do not exist in Chrome. Chrome doesn't let you tweak any of these things. Full stop. Yeah, that's why I use Firefox. Okay, that's as far as I know, but based on what I believe, based on sort of the, I don't know, overall, the way that the Chromium developers, or the way that, you know, I believe they operate, right? I don't think they will have these sort of tweaks anyway, or they will ever implement these sort of tweaks, because, it's just how they are. Shift right click works on Chrome. That means you can override the context menu. I guess that is new. Let's see. Yeah, but it also depends, shift right click may not be shift right click working in Chrome, it depends on where you test it, right? Maybe the website itself checking for the shift key and then deciding that deciding to bypass, right? Because people complain or they specifically allow for it to bypass the context menu, right? But in Firefox it's a browser thing that no matter the way you do it. So there are a lot of websites, especially in the past, where they are trying to stop you from viewing source, right? So they disable the right-click context menu. In Firefox, you can just shift right-click to bypass that as well. I mean, it's the same JavaScript event handler, right? Yep, so these are some of the tweaks in About Config that enhance your browsing experience. Actually, there are a lot more things you can tweak in About Config that especially if you're running in Linux where hardware acceleration is not enabled by default, right? If you do want to look into that, I think you can go to the Arch wiki. Yes, you can go to the Arch wiki and then you can look into the different acceleration. Yeah, there are a lot of tips and tricks here as well. So like on the ArchWiki, you know, as you know, the ArchWiki has many, many things, right? So like you can tweak like the web render. You can enable web render on Linux and accelerated OMTP and so on. But this is more of performance, which I won't really touch on. How to stop videos from autoplaying? I think they already do so, right? I believe you can. Yeah, so Chrome has some advanced settings, but they don't allow you to do any of these things, as far as I know. Inside there is more like enabling, you know, some beta features or things like that, which not say super useful. How to stop YouTube videos from going to next video after ending? You can just switch off the YouTube autoplay. There's an autoplay toggle, isn't there? Yeah. Okay. Anyway, let's move on. Developer tools, yes. So the browser developer tools are quite useful. Like it's not only useful for development, right? You can use it for many things. So for example, if you want to scrape data off a website or something, right, you can always use the developer tools as a one-off thing, right? Or there are some websites that don't let you download images. So for example, like Flickr, right? So let's say, yes, this looks safe. So let's say I want to download this photo, and you see that the author hasn't. Okay, in this case, the author has let you download it. But in some cases, if there is a photo where the author doesn't let you download the photo, which the author can, as in the uploader can enable that, right? Then what you can do is just open the DevTools, right, by pressing F12, and just use the inspector to go to that. Go to the photo, and if you click around a bit, so let me just hide this and hide this. So then you can go to the inspector tab, which will show you the elements in the page, right? And you can go to the element picker. Yeah, if you can, you can screenshot and cut and paste, but you don't get the full quality, you see. So you go to element picker, and you just find the particular element, the image, right? And then you can eventually, if you click around a bit, you will find the image tag here. Then you just, and sometimes, yeah. So like Flickr, for example, has this multiple resolutions, right? So you just find the highest resolution one, and then you can just open the direct image directly, and then now you can download the full resolution of the image. You can do this. So this works for like other websites, for example, like Instagram. So like you can follow us on Instagram. We do have Instagram. Let's say you want to download our poster for whatever reason, right? Number one, I wouldn't say it's stealing, because if your browser can view the image, then your browser itself has downloaded it. So you can download and save the file. It's just if you want to use the photo for something else, like in a poster or whatever, if you want to download the image download the image is okay. It's when you want to use it in something else or in a poster or whatever work that you're submitting, right? That's when the issue is. That's where the issue is. I will say downloading anything is not a problem. Yeah, so a lot of the time shift right click doesn't work. So for example, if I want to download this, I'm shift right clicking now, but you see there's nothing, save option, you see. So again, you can just pull up the DevTools and open this up, and then you can have, there you have the original, the URL to the image, which you can then download for whatever reason. I'm not saying why you would download this, but you can do it using a DevTools. This is just an example of what you can do with the DevTools, right? Just remember that whatever that your browser can show to you, the browser has to download from the server. So if the browser can download it from the server, that means you can probably download it from the server as well, right? Unless you're talking about like Netflix, where they have client-side DRM, right? Then that gets a bit more tricky, lah. Yeah. The other things you can do like scraping. So, for example, you will need like JavaScript knowledge for this. You need JavaScript knowledge for this. So like, but you know, if you open up the DevTools and let's say I want to get, all the links in the page, for example, I can just say, right. So, if you don't have the slides already, here is the link to the slides. Again. Okay, where was I? Yes. So you can use the developer tools to sort of scrape things off a page, right? I was saying that you need JavaScript knowledge for this. Let me just walk through this simply. So you have document accesses the document object. This is a global variable in the window context. Then there's this function called query selector all, which accepts a CSS query. And yeah, so you can key in a CSS selector here. And so this will select all the anchor or A elements, right? And then I'm just going to do this to convert it into an array, right? And then I can now map it to like, then I get all the links in my current page, lah. Right, and then if I want, I can just join it with, and then show it, and then I can copy and paste it. Right. These are some examples of ways you can use the developer tools to scrape data, a lot of things you can do. And of course, especially for websites that are more complicated, or like web apps, right? Sometimes, especially when you have ad blockers enabled, the site might stop working. So one of the ways you can debunk what's happening is to look in the console. It's just a way to look for potential problems. Like, most of the time, there's nothing of interest in the console. So that is some of the things you can do with the developer tools. Yeah. Of course, there's like, if you want to do funny things, for example, like, edit the page and then take a screenshot, you can do that also. But that's why you shouldn't really trust screenshots of websites, because like, it's very easy to edit the content just using the dev tools. Let me just edit this to it. Yeah, see. What's the funny? What are you talking about? Oh, that's my font. I mean, this symbol, this is my font. It's called IOSEFCA. It's a ligature, lah. Right. Let's see. What questions? What about bypassing Straits Times Premium? You can't do that because that is a server-sided thing. You can't bypass things on the server. Can developer tools see JWT token data? Yes. Usually the JWT token will be... The JWT token will usually be like, sent in the... So you can look at the network request, right? And then usually the JWT token will be sent like as a header in the request. So like during Angela's question. All right. Back to the slides. Yes, so that is the DevTools. now we can go on to something less involved. So like we have this idea of a bookmarklet, right? So a bookmark is, as you know, it's like a URL that you save. Right, so what is a bookmarklet? A bookmarklet is like basically it's like a bookmark except the URL starts with JavaScript colon. So basically this is a JavaScript protocol, and basically whatever is after it is run as JavaScript code in the current page's context. So they're very useful. They're useful snippets of JavaScript to do things, right? So for example, if you are an NUS student, you will know that there is the NUS library's bookmarklet, which you can Google, right? The proxy bookmarklet. So basically, there are instructions here, but once you have the bookmarklet, you can just, when you go to like a website, so like, for example, I can't show it because I have Zotero enabled. Let me disable it first. And I don't know, let's go to nature. Yes, the bookmarklet works on phones. I use it on my phone as well. Yeah, it should work. You can should be able to save the bookmarklet and use it. Although I don't know, it depends on the browser, I guess. I use it on Firefox last time. It may or may not work now, and I don't know about Chrome on the phone. Okay, let me see. Let us find a paper, and hopefully it's yes. Okay, so you see here, I need to log in to access it, right? So one of your options is of course Sci-Hub, right? But if your institution, for example NUS, has access to it, then you might as well use your institution's access to it, So in this case, I have the proxy bookmarklet. As a keyword, right? So I just need to key in libproxy. But basically, you just open up the bookmark, and press enter, and then it will bring you to this, to the NUS login page, And I will not log in on screen, but once you log in, right, once you log in, then yes, so you'll see that the URL has changed to be proxied through your institution, right? And now you should have access if your institution has access to whatever it is, right? So that is the proxy bookmarklet, right? So there are other bookmarklets. So for example, if you are an NUS student, again, there is a I'm sure you know what Panopto is. It's basically where all the web lectures recorded lectures are stored, right? There you can probably search for more bookmarklets. These are the useful ones that I've found. So there are actually not many of them, but it's something that you can use. And this one here just basically removes any right-click handler from the website. So if the website is trying to block right-clicks, can possibly use this bookmarklet to remove its right-click handler and then try. Although this doesn't remove all possible ways of handling or intercepting right-clicks, so it may not work. This particular bookmarklet. And there are also those bookmarklets that just do funny things, Yeah, okay. So there's this bookmarklet that adds a fly to the page. Yeah, there you go. Yeah, so there's some bookmarklets that just do stupid things. But no, it's all JavaScript, right? So if you can get JavaScript to run on the website, then you can do whatever you want to the website. All right, let's move on. Anyone have any questions so far? Okay. Yes, now we get to more useful things, maybe. We have browser extensions, right? So I'm sure everyone knows about this extension, uBlock Origin. It is a well, ad blocker, right? If you do not use, if you use some other ad blocker, I do recommend you use uBlock Origin. It's probably the most sort of transparent one. Maybe there are new ones out there that I don't know, but I still use uBlock Origin. So there are some ad blockers like AdBlock, AdBlock Plus, and so on that sort of are commercial in a sense, right? So they're trying to earn money from making AdBlock, right? Which is kind of weird because if the extension is free, and who's going to pay them to make develop AdBlock, right? So actually what they do is like they accept payments from ad companies so that they will basically whitelist certain advertisements from that company, right? So if you're using those extensions, well, kind of basically the extension is the developers of that those extensions are being paid to are being paid to whitelist advertisements by ad companies. So then you might as, yeah, so that's why I don't recommend you use AdBlock Plus and AdBlock and certain other ad blocks that are basically commercial. This is the trusted one, right? So this link is a Firefox link. This link is a Chromium/Chrome link. Does it work on videos? Yes, uBlock Origin can block YouTube advertisements for now, right? I'm sure Google is working on getting advertisements sort of in-stream. When I say in-stream, means that it's sort of encoded into the video stream so that you can't just filter them out. Yeah. So that's uBlock. Let me show you. So you have uBlock here, and yeah, you can open the settings, and then like basically they will uBlock will come with a set of default filters that enable, but you can go in and you can go in and enable more. So like I like to enable these annoyance and social filters. Basically they hide all the stupid share icons and whatever not in the from websites, right? Because like who actually uses those icons? Okay, I don't love it. And you also hide certain annoyances, like what is there, like yeah, basically share buttons and those kinds of things that basically detract you from the website. I mean, of course the primary filters are like like easy list, which is like I think the biggest ad blocking list currently, right? And others, some privacy list here. So easy list is like to block ads, right? Easy privacy blocks trackers, so like analytics and things like that. And easy list also does that. Yeah, but if you want, you can go and enable all of these or less of these. It's really up to you. But of course, the more filters you enable, then the more it will have a slight performance impact on your browsing, right? So the thing about ad blockers is that it does take some time every time you open a page to sort of like filter out all the ads and things. But the funny thing is that nowadays, right, a lot of pages are so heavy and bloated with ads, right, that this extra little computation that you use to block ads, right, actually saves a lot more time compared to, because the ads themselves take up so much bandwidth and processing power to render, right? That blocking them actually saves and a bit of processing power you take to block them actually saves more time and makes the page just faster in general. Yeah, you should give it a try, and you will notice, especially if you are on your phone, right? Okay, on the mobile, only Firefox for Android lets you use add-ons, so like including ad blockers. There are some mobile browsers that have a built-in ad blocker, but currently only Firefox has actual plugins that you can use, right? So the new version has some limitations on what plugins that can be installed. New version of Firefox Android. Yeah. And if you are on iOS, I cannot help you. Things like login to view document banners. Is there a filter to enable, but or does it block by default? What kind of login to view document banners? Okay. The next add-on I have is a stylus. Stylus is a user style manager. So what is a user style? Basically, it's like custom CSS that you apply to a website. So if you notice, my GitHub is dark, right? And that is because I have a user style installed called GitHub dark, right? And you can actually look for this user style. It's very popular, right? It's on GitHub as well, right? So you can just install this theme, and then you can get a dark GitHub, right? If you prefer dark themes, right? So this is again the Firefox link. This is again the Chromium link. You can search for other user styles as well on the userstyles.org website. So userstyles.org recommends this plugin called Stylish, but there was some I don't know. They were found to be sort of sending your data off to. They were found to be collecting your data, so that's why people no longer recommend the Stylish plugin, although they were the primary one, as in they were the most popular plugin initially, and then now it's Stylus. So that's user styles, and then we have this thing called user scripts, right? So user styles is a CSS that runs a custom CSS that you apply on websites. User scripts are like a custom JavaScript that you apply that runs on whatever website you specify them to run on, right? So you can get some user scripts on these two websites. There's a lot of user scripts. So like especially the popular websites have certain user scripts that add certain or functionality or shortcuts or things like that, right? So this, user scripts can sort of, because they run arbitrary JavaScript on whatever website, so they can sort of add, whatever functionality that you want. Please don't mind this. Nowadays, a lot of popular user scripts have become a full-fledged add-on. So like, if you go to the, so for example, like Reddit Enhancement Suite, if you use Reddit, right? It started off as a user script, I believe, but now it's packaged as a full add-on as well, right? And they add a lot of things to your Reddit, to like Reddit also, like, to sort of enhance your experience, right? But you can also write your own user script. So I do not have the add-on enabled currently because I currently don't use any user scripts personally. There's my control panel. There we go. So, you can write your own user scripts to, you can write your own user scripts to do things, right? So there is this, there's this user script that does basically helps you bypass certain interstitial screens. So skip countdown timers, especially for those certain file upload or download websites and things like that. That's one user script. But honestly, the most useful things thing I use PilotMonkey nowadays is to write my own customizations to websites. So you can see here that I have a certain I have this thing called CodeCrunch inline source, right? What this does was, CodeCrunch is a website that NUS uses to School of Computing uses to where for students to submit their assignments and things like that. So the interface is honestly very dated and old. So like as a TA, I was trying to grade my students' work, and like I had to click open each file one by one. So I just wrote a script to add a button that actually showed me all the each of the files in a submission inline and give it syntax highlighting and things like that. So there are some things you can do with a user script. Yeah. So like those kind of countdown timers, like SourceForges, depending on the, I'm not sure if the plugin actually helps with that, but yeah, I'm talking, those are the countdown timers that we're talking about. So a user script is basically something that just starts or runs when your page runs, right? So then you can just do anything to the page. So you can like use whatever DOM, APIs to like add new buttons that do different things, manipulate the page and so on, right? Yeah. So I'll have an example here basically. So like example of what you can do with a user script. Again, you can do anything with a user script, but so if you go to slide 13.2, you go to your user script manager, you can create a new user script and just paste it here, right? So what this user script does is basically, if you go to the Google, Google, yep, it will automatically fill in the search box and then submit it for you, right? So we can give that a try. So let me now go to Google. And you can see that it has submitted. So yeah, this is one of the things you can do with user scripts, which is to automate a certain whatever, right? So like last time, if you are from NTU or if, yeah. So NTU's module bidding system is this very clunky thing called STARS, right? Which is basically a first come first serve system. So it's kind of terrible. So I helped my friend write a script basically that just automatically clicks on goes through the process of clicking for and submitting to try and get the module or her, the modules that she needed, right? It was kind of silly, but in the end there were no vacancies, so in the end it didn't help anyway. But you know, for the entire period that of 3 hours, I believe that the module bidding or the STARS period was open, then basically her browser was there just clicking through and trying to get the module. So that's some of the things you can do with user scripts. Yeah. So that is a Violet Monkey, right? And there's this add-on called Freestyle Tabs, right? Which if you are one of those people that like to have lots of tabs open, right? This tab or this add-on might be useful for you. Basically, it gives you this tree style tab panel at the side. So like basically the children are, if you open this tab from this tab, then it will be a child of this tab. So like you can sort of see the relationships between each tab, you know? I'm not someone that likes to have a lot of tabs open, so I don't really use this add-on. But if you use this add-on, I'm sure, or if you like to have a lot of tabs open, I'm sure this will be useful for you, lah. And there is this plugin called Google Link Search Fix. So basically, what this does is Let me first disable Violet Monkey again, because yeah. So let me first disable the add-on, right? So I can show you what it actually does, right? So if you go to a Google page, right, and you want to let's say you have this search result and you want to copy the link, right? And the moment it seems like Google doesn't actually do it anymore. So then I guess the add-on is no longer needed. So in the past, right? In the past, when you were to right-click on a link, right? And try to copy it. Try the YouTube link. Yeah, it doesn't do it anymore. So basically what happens in the past is that when you try and copy a link, right? Google will actually like... maybe I try Chrome. Google will actually like transform the link to something else that goes through Google so they can sort of track the link, right? Seems like they do not do it anymore, so that's good. So like this add-on is not needed anymore. But what this add-on did was to stop Google from doing that, so you could safely copy and paste a link without it being transformed into some link that goes through Google. Yep. And there's this tool called HTTPS Everywhere, which basically it just forces websites forces your browser to go through HTTPS whenever you get a link that is non-HTTPS, right? So for security reasons and privacy, because you don't want to use unencrypted HTTP, so then you can install this add-on and use it. I don't use it because it has, in the past, right, when I use it, there are certain websites that still don't support HTTPS properly. So I use this when, like, I will have to whitelist certain websites and I got a bit frustrated, so I didn't use it. But I believe nowadays it's a lot better, so you can probably install it if you are, if you sort of care about your privacy. I wouldn't say I believe nowadays it's more about privacy than security, because any website where the security actually matters would already be on HTTPS lah. So like this is just for like the other websites that don't have HTTPS by default, and if they don't have HTTPS by default nowadays, then they are not really like anything important lah, honestly. It's just whether you care whether your ISP and other people can sort of spy on what websites that you are looking at lah. So I would say nowadays it's more of a privacy thing. Yes. And finally, there's this add-on called the Zotero Connector. So before we talk about Zotero Connector, I should talk about what Zotero is, right? Zotero is this very useful I have it disabled for some reason. Yeah, Zotero is this add-on that is very useful. So like, for example, you are researching for something, so like let's see. What can I search on? Let's look for cache replacement, right? And one of the things Zotero can do is basically you go to a website and you want to save the website to your... You want to save the website so you can look at it later, right? So you can just click Save to Zotero. And let me launch Zotero. So actually what Zotero is a reference or citation manager. So like if you're researching on things, right, you can use it to save like your journal articles and such and things like that. Right. So now if I'm searching for something and now I just want to save this, I can just click on this button and I will say save it to my library. Save it somewhere with less pages. So now you can see it has not been saved yet. Oh, okay. I don't know why it asked me this, but yeah. So now it's saved. No, it's not saving the article itself. It's saving it's just saving the URL. So like you can even save other things. So for example, if I go to YouTube, I have a YouTube video that I want to save or track, right?
So
I can just click here and it will save it as well. So it's just a way for you to track resources or pages or things that you are looking at. Right? And so that's Zotero. And then Zotero Connector, which is the add-on that I'm talking about, is just an extension that integrates your browser with Zotero. So you can easily save things to Zotero. So then here it saves as a video recording. And you can basically and then it helps you to generate citations and things as well. So like you can look more into Zotero if you want, but Zotero is not the focus of this. Not our focus here. It's more of the add-on to integrate it with Firefox. Yeah. Oh, but one of the things Zotero connector does do, right, you can see here it says that it automatically redirected my request to through my through the NUS libraries proxy, right? That's because I have access to this all the articles on this by this publisher through the NUS libraries proxy. So Zotero actually remember that for you, and then when you access a page, when you access a page, right, it will actually then redirect it through the proxy for you, so that now you can see it tells me access provided by NUS, like in my case, right? So if you have access to the article via institution, Zotero record once the first time you log in through you log into your proxy to access the website, Zotero will remember that, okay, this website, I can use this proxy. And then subsequent times that you access that this website, Zotero will help you redirect to through your proxy. So, and one of the things Zotero can do is also like, you see I'm on Google Scholar, right? And so I have a lot of results here that I want to, that I could potentially look through. So let's say I've looked through some of them and I want these results, I can just click save, right? And Zotero recognize that, okay, I have quite a few items that I can save, and then I can just pick the ones I want to save and then press okay to save them. And I'm going to remove this from my, yes. Yeah. So that is Zotero. So it works on both, of course, your mobile, it works on Firefox and Chrome. I do not think it works on mobile. Yeah. So if you do research, Zotero and Zotero Connector are very useful. Very useful, like really, really useful. Because when you're researching things, you will really get lost in like all the different citations that you have, and then like you having something to help you organize and track them and collect them into a little all together in a place where you can look through them later on is very useful. Yeah. So I've talked about user scripts and web API. So there are a number of useful web APIs, but I think the most common one that I personally use is like the Telegram bot API, right? So the bot API is a simple HTTP interface over the Telegram API or Telegram protocol, right? So like you can sort of use it from the command line as a way to just send yourself simple, you know, notifications when something is done or something like that. So let me give you an example, right? Basically, what you can do, right, the workshop on Telegram bots is to use to write a Telegram bot itself, but the Telegram bot API, right, you can use it in other ways as well, as like simple notifications or something like that. So what I can do is to create a bot, right? And right, so now I have a token. And now I can basically send myself a message through the bot. You first need to talk to your bot, of course, and press the start button so that the bot can talk to you, right? And then now I can you will replace token here with your bot token, which you can get from BotFather. Where is BotFather? Yeah, which you can get from BotFather. So I have got my token, and then I so my chat ID is this, right? So I'm just gonna send myself a message, right? And the parameter is called text. So And you can see that my bot has now sent me a message, right? So then you can enable notifications for your bot, right? So like, let's say you are doing a build or something long running, right? And then you want it to notify you when it's done. You can just use something like that. So a simple curl, you know, curl command to send a message, an API request to the Telegram bot API. And right. So when the whatever operation you're doing is done, then you will get a message from your bot and you will know. And it's, if you have Telegram, then you will have Telegram on your phone and your laptop and whatever, right? So then you will just see the notification from your bot, right? So that's a simple web API trick that you can use. Let me close some of these. Right. Yeah. So there's also this thing called IFTTT, which stands for if this then that, right? So this is a service that sort of glues many services, or lets you create like sort of pipelines that glue services together, which you can also then use to sort of you can also trigger from the command line using curl or curl, right? Yeah, so I won't go into that, but you can take a look into it if you have something you want to automate, right? You can probably look into this and it can probably do it for you. So some of the things you can do is like like when you, okay, the things it's intended for, like, or when you upload or when you make a new tweet, you can convert it to an Instagram post and then post it on Instagram or something like that. But you can also like trigger it from the command line and things like that. Yeah. So, and finally, I won't be going through this today, but you can also look at the automation with Selenium, right? So Selenium is a tool to let you control browsers programmatically, right? So it's used for testing, right? Like when you are testing a web application, you want to test it as if a user were using it. But you can use it for anything as well. Basically, it lets you control a browser and pick things. So if you want to, like, I don't know, you need to log into a website periodically to check something, right? You can probably use Selenium to do it, right? And then like, so you can, let's say you want to track your package, you know, your package or your courier doesn't have a nice API for you to use, then you can just use their, you can just use the courier's website, right? And then use Selenium to sort of automate the website. So you, Selenium will help you open up the, you can like open up the page in Selenium, then find the tracking bar, fill it in with the tracking number, click the submit button, and then after that, extract the image or the extract the results from the results page, and then like send it to you via Telegram bot. So that's something you could do with Selenium. Yeah. So that's the end of the browsers and web section. So now I'll talk about security and privacy. This part will be slightly shorter, I hope, because it's already 8 o'clock. You know, when you talk about security, it's good to have some general knowledge and also like some knowledge of the things that are happening around you, right? So yeah, so it's good to follow security blogs. So like, you know, of course, Tryhan is a quite a well-known security guy, right? So he talks about different incidents and things that happen in the internet world, things like that. And there's this website that gives you some sort of background knowledge as well as base knowledge on like security and things like that. So you can just start off from here, right? And then you need to decide, like, you know, when you talk about security and privacy, you need to decide and you need to know what exactly your sort of threat model is. When I say threat model, it means like, who exactly are you defending yourself against, right? So for example, if you care about your ISP or the government, right, trying to track you or get your data or, you know, things like that, then you will choose to do things in a way to sort of minimize that risk. Or if you don't care about that, and what you just worry about is like, if I lose my laptop, will the person who gets my laptop be able to hack into all my accounts, right? Yeah, if that's your threat model, then you wouldn't worry so much about certain things, and you only need to have ensure a baseline level of security, like for example password on your computer and so on, so that you're just protected against your threat model. So the reason you need to know this is because you can't just decide that you want to make everything 100% secure, right? Because like there's always a trade-off when you make things more secure. Like basically, it's always a trade-off between security and convenience. So more secure means less convenient, because you have to go through whatever security measures that you have put in, right? But if you make it more convenient, then it's also usually more convenient for the attacker to attack, right? The thing about it is, if your laptop gets confiscated, like PJ Tam, then legally you are probably required to provide the government, the police assistance and help them do the investigations they need, sort of security is kind of a technical thing, right? It doesn't stop you from, it doesn't help you, it doesn't protect you against like legal requirements to decrypt your data, for example. What if your threat model is torrent downloads? I don't understand what you mean. Yeah. So I'm not sure if you have seen, if you know what XKCD is. It's a online webcomic that it's a sort of a geeky webcomic, I guess, that talks about makes fun about many things, but one of these is like this comic is about basically passwords. So like this is sort of the this is a common way that people were recommended, or people recommended to make passwords last time. So you take a word, right? Then you do some substitutions and you add in some special characters, right? But the thing is, like, this password is kind of hard to remember, right? Because you remember, oh, which letters did I change to numbers, and what, which letters did I not change to numbers, and what symbol did I put in, and so on and so forth, right? But the thing is, this password is very short, right? So it's kind of easy for a computer to guess, But if you just choose a string of words, right? For example, this. Even if the attacker knows that your password is four words, right? There are a lot more words possible than the fact that there are so many words that even just four words is very hard. It's harder to guess than these how many characters? 11 characters. So yeah. So nowadays, when you're choosing passwords, I would say number one is to use a password manager, which I'll talk about in a bit. But if you're not using a password manager, then I would say it's probably better to focus on length rather than the longer the password, the better. And of course, you should use number, special characters, and so on. But the longer password, a longer password is usually better than a shorter password. That password is more vulnerable to brute force with limited character set. Yes, but the attacker may not know that, you see. You need to think about what the attacker knows. So if the attacker doesn't know that, then they're going to try capital letters as well as numbers and special characters as well. They don't know that your password is only lowercase. But of course, you have to, it depends on your threat model, again. If you assume that the attacker knows that your password is four words, then of course it's easier. Then you need to go longer, but if you are looking at a normal website where the attacker may only have a hash, for example, they can't really derive any other information about your password. Then they wouldn't. They will still try all the other different kinds of, all the different kinds of characters, because they don't know that your password is only four words. And yes, you should sign up for this website called Have I Been Pwned? Basically, this website just tells you whether your email address has, you know, has been compromised in data breaches. Most likely, if you have used your email address for more than a few years, right? Most likely, it has appeared in some data breach somewhere. Chances are lah. But just because it has appeared in a data breach doesn't mean that your password is or your email address will be hacked or you are insecure. It's just that it has appeared in a data breach somewhere, lor. Okay, password managers. There are a lot of password managers out there. These are some of them. So the bottom two are cloud-based and commercial solutions. These are also the two that you keep hearing on like YouTube, you know, sponsors and like they always sponsor YouTube videos and tell you, oh, you can use, don't know what. But anyway, I don't recommend LastPass anymore because I think they were bought over by LogMeIn. I mean, I don't recommend 1Password either, lah, but if you really want to use one of these, I would recommend that you use I recommend that you use 1Password instead of LastPass, right? There's also Bitwarden, which is an open source, self-hostable, cloud-based password manager. Yeah, so if you want a cloud-based one, you look at Bitwarden. But what I think most people will use something like, I don't know. I know some people use Pass, which is basically a command line password manager, but I think a lot of people use KeePass or KeePass XC. Right. So KeePass is the original one that is written in .NET, right? So mainly for Windows. And there's an open source C++ port of KeePass. That is KeePass XC and works on all three platforms. So let me show you KeePass XC. Right, so this is KeePass XC. And right, so how do you use it? You just create a new database, right? And then you can call it something. And here you can tweak the encryption settings. So I recommend you just select the latest database format. Decryption time here is basically the amount of time it takes for the how many rounds of encryption you want to do on your database key. Basically, how this works is that when your passphrase will go through a few rounds of processing before it reaches the actual before the actual key that is used to encrypt the database is derived. So this is to prevent or hinder brute forcing, right? So that, you know, if someone wants to brute force your database password, they have to do this amount of work for every attempt. So you can just leave it as 2 seconds, right? And you can just key in a password. I'm going to use a simple password. And you can add in other protectors. So like you can have a key file and you have a YubiKey. You can also use a YubiKey as well to sort of protect your database, right? Yeah. Then save the file and so you'll see an empty database. So what you can do is create a new entry, right? Let's say Google, right? And then you can have your password here. So if you use a password manager, usually they'll come with a password generator as well, right? And this is where you can go. No, this is KeePass XC. Which is a port of KeePass. You can also use KeePass, it works basically the same. So when you use a password manager, this is where you can sort of go, I won't say overboard, but you can go crazy with your password length, right? So you can use like 60. I won't be talking about pass, because I think the easiest option, and I personally use KeePass XC, so this is what I recommend. It's the easiest to use, and it's reasonably trusted, and so on. So you can generate a password, and since you're using a password manager, you can just go with like a 64 character and enable all the different character types, right? Yeah. So then it will generate the password for you, and then you can just press OK. Right. So now, let's say you are logging into Google. And yeah, so can just okay. Yeah, let's just, for example, this is your password field, right? What you can do is just you select the field, then you go to here, and then you can type auto type password, and then it'll boom. Okay. I need to tweak the. Let me use a text editor for demonstration purposes. So basically, you can press the auto type button and then you will just go to whatever program that you were last at. Right? And then you will just type in your username and password. Right? But for me, I don't like to have it key in my username because I usually have the username keyed in for me. So you can. You can change what exactly it auto types. So like, for example, you can just change it to say that I just want it to key in my password for me, right? And then, yeah, now if I do an auto type, it'll just key in my password, right? Then I can press enter myself, right? The other option is, of course, you can just copy the password, right? And then, so I'll just copy it and then paste it, right? And that also works. But I will say using the auto type is slightly more secure because like other applications can read the clipboard. Of course, other applications can also intercept these simulated keystrokes, but it's slightly harder. Easier to just look at the clipboard. Yeah. So that's how you basically use a password manager. And so of course your master password has to be secure, but the benefit is that you can make that super secure and then you only need to remember that one master password. Versus having to remember a number of passwords, or even like worse is like sharing passwords between websites, what about mobile usage for the non-cloud based mobile usage for these? Okay, so there are mobile apps for like KeePass, right? So like you can just what you can do is just like put your database in like a Dropbox or something, right? Because your database is actually encrypted, so it's actually safe to upload to, even if it's public, right? It's probably safe, right? You can just put it somewhere online and the encryption is secure. So like, no one can really decrypt it unless they know the password. Yeah. So you can just put it on Dropbox or whatever cloud service, or you can run your own cloud service even, and then, then you can just sync it through that. So there are mobile apps that for KeePass and KeePass XC. Probably not Pass because it's a command line one. And these all have mobile apps because they're all cloud based. What if you break your computer? Well, you always need backups, right? That's password managers. Yes. If you are really, really paranoid about, paranoid or not paranoid, but you really want to be safe, right? You should keep a copy of your password database and then put it in a safe deposit box or somewhere safe. I won't say paranoid, if you really want to be really, really, really safe, right? But I would say, I don't know, it depends on how much effort you want to. Only it depends on how much effort you really want to put into, your online security. Again, it's always a trade-off, right? Between effort, security, and convenience. Yes. Okay. If you're on MINDEF, if you're working for MINDEF, then doesn't MINDEF have the smart card anyway? So like that's your 2FA already. Yes, full disk encryption is required in most large organizations, but I mean, this is for your personal use. You might want to encrypt your own drive as well. So let's talk about that, right? So what's the point of full disk encryption? So basically, so encrypt your entire hard drive. So like someone who actually picks up your laptop, for example, if you, for example, drop it or lose it, right? If they don't have your, but without full disk encryption, if someone just got your hard drive, right, they will be able to just plug it into another computer and access all your files, right? But if you have full disk encryption, then they will need to be able to, they will need to know your disk key, lah, which is maybe a passphrase or like maybe stored in your computer's trusted secure module or TPM, right? Which is, which will only work if the computer has not been tampered with, right? So on Windows, you have like a BitLocker, right? That one is quite straightforward to use. You just enable it, right? There's not much things you can tweak. But I'm not I believe it's only available on Pro, unless your laptop ships with BitLocker enabled. On Linux, you can look into this thing called Lux or DMCrypt, right? Of course, it's out of scope of the today of actually how to set this up, because it's not that easy. But I believe if you are using like Ubuntu, there may be some graphical tools to help you do this, maybe in the installer. Mac OS has this thing called File Vault, right? And then there's this thing called VeraCrypt, which I will just quickly demo now. Right, so VeraCrypt is a continuation of the tool called TrueCrypt. Right, and basically it lets you create a new encrypted drive lah, that you can just do whatever. So you can just create a new volume, right? And you can say create an encrypted file container, right? So this will create a file which contains a disk image that is encrypted. Right, then you can say standard or hidden. So a hidden volume is basically like for you to have some sort of plausible deniability. Basically, if you feel like you may be in a situation where someone may force you to reveal your encryption key, then you can create a hidden volume that basically there's a visible volume that is there's basically two volumes. So if you give the key, if someone forces you to reveal the key, you can just give the key that will encrypt, they'll decrypt the sort of decoy volume, right? And then your actual files will be sort of won't be seen. I'll just go with a normal volume, right? And then I'm just gonna select, right? And you can select the encryption algorithm, but the default is usually fine. And let's just make it a small volume, so like let's make it 16 megabyte volume. Right, and I'm just going to use a simple password again. Right. Yes. And they're telling me that I shouldn't use a short password, obviously. Right. So now I will just whatever format. Okay, so now has been created. So now I will just exit, and then I will say select this file. So my volume is here, right? And I will just say mount, and then now you'll ask me for my password, right? And it needs a sudo to mount the volume. So now yes, the volume has been mounted. So if I go to, where is it? Yes, so can then open the volume, right? And then you open the, so now this directory, the volume has been mounted into this directory. So I can just copy files in here, right? And it'll be written encrypted into my encrypted container, right? So I can then just copy this container into like, so you could just have this, you could just create this on a thumb drive, for example. And so whatever that you put into the encrypted VeraCrypt drive will be encrypted and be on the thumb drive, right? So that's how I use VeraCrypt. So this is more for like, external drives and things like that. So you can encrypt your entire external drive as well, and then you will need VeraCrypt to unlock it. Yeah. Okay, let me unmount. And you can also use VeraCrypt as well to encrypt your OS drive, right? But I think nowadays it's probably easier and better to just use your OS, your OS's built-in encryption. So like whatever, these three unless you do not trust your OS vendor, then you maybe want to use VeraCrypt. Because VeraCrypt is open source, so you could audit it yourself if you wanted, in theory. Yes, so that is full disk encryption. When you install any flavor of Linux, they ask if you want to encrypt your hard disk, how does one log in and what are the cases it protects? Okay. Let me answer that at the end because I'm running out of time. Yes. So the thing about full disk encryption, of course, is that like the weakest link, basically you're shifting the weakest link from your data or the hard drive being able to be accessed by anyone to just like yourself, like, or now you're moving to human factors, right? Because if they can't access the files in your hard drive directly, then they will just coerce you to get it or get the password, right? So that's the thing about security, the weakest link is usually the human. And plausible deniability. So I talk about that. Okay, file-based encryption. So maybe you just so just now we talked about full disk encryption. That means we're encrypting an entire drive, right? So you will use these tools to do that, as well as VeraCrypt, right? If sometimes you just want to sort of encrypt one file, maybe you are sending it over the internet to someone or something like that, and you just want to encrypt one file, right, then you can use these tools, right? Okay, these tools are a bit special, right? Basically, they create a sort of virtual file system, right, over a regular file system. So whatever files you put into the virtual file system will be encrypted and written to the file system that is mounted on top of. They use this to sort of like set, basically like if they want to encrypt the files they put in, for example, Dropbox, if they do not trust Dropbox, right? Then you can use this and then set the base directory as your Dropbox, right? So that then you just put files into this virtual directory so that whatever files are put into this directory will be saved onto Dropbox. But it'll be encrypted so that Dropbox cannot see the contents of your files. VeraCrypt can be used to encrypt. It can be used to create containers or encrypted containers, like as I showed just now as well. The difference between this one and this one is that this one will encrypt an individual files, right, and then put save it onto the backing file system. VeraCrypt just creates one encrypted container, which contains a file system by itself. So like it'll if you want to use it with something like Dropbox, for example, it's probably better to use something like this, instead of like having one huge file, that is encrypted. Right, it will work better with the Dropbox sync algorithm, lah. And if you just want to share a file and encrypt it for whatever reason, if you're sending personal data over email, right, your organization may require you to encrypt it to comply with PDPA. So then you can sort of use these tools to do that. In the past, I've used 7-Zip, right? So 7-Zip, you can just, when you're creating an archive with 7-Zip, there is a field there to key in a password, right? So you can just key in a password. Note that 7-Zip encryption is different from the zip file encryption, right? The zip file encryption is basically useless. 7-zip encryption is AES, so it's still reasonably okay. I think there were some questions about how exactly it derived the encryption key from the passphrase, but I don't think anyone has found major issues with the way 7-zip does its encryption, right? And there are also these two tools, command line tools used to encrypt files as well. You can go and look into them. I personally use H currently. When I'm my automated backups of certain things on my computer, I will create an archive on them and then pass them through H, right? And H is uses asymmetric encryption, so like you can have a public key right, and a public private key, right? So then people who want to encrypt things and send it to you can use the public key, right? And then you will need the private key to decrypt it. So like so like on my, you know, on my servers and things where I don't want to have my private key there, I can just put my, I can just use H and then have a, use my public key. Like the server backup scripts can just encrypt it to my public key, and then like I can just throw the backup on any, you know, whatever cloud storage. I once used Telegram as my cloud storage for one of my one of the NUS hackers servers. So like the Hack and Roll 2020 server, the backup was actually done to Telegram, right? Because Telegram provides you unlimited cloud storage, right? So I just used that and encrypted it so that to my back then I used GPG, but you know, it's basically the same idea. So you don't have to trust Telegram because it's encrypted. You just need to trust your encryption. How is H performance? Honestly, I don't know. It's fast enough for me. Yes, Anchive is another tool that is similar to H. Yeah. Oops. Okay. Let's talk about VPN services, right? Why would you use a VPN service? Basically, it's more or less to protect your online privacy, but I honestly feel like the benefits of using VPN services are not that great, because basically if you don't trust your ISP, then you might want to use a VPN so that whatever is, so that then you create an encrypted tunnel between yourself and your VPN provider. But then your VPN provider will be able to sort of see whatever traffic that you are passing through them. So you need to trust your VPN provider. Yes, I remember not had some issues. The one that I recommend now is Malvat. Because basically the way they work is I can right now create a new account. Right. And Malvat just works by account number. You do not need to give them any other information, right? And you can just pay them by whatever means. So like if you really want, you can email them cash. Not email, sorry. You can send them snail mail cash, right? So they do not know who the hell you are at all. And but I mean, it's kind of inconvenient. But you can also pay them by Bitcoin also, and so, or credit card, but then credit card is sort of trackable, right? So Malvat is cool, I think, because there's no information, just account number. So you don't give them email or anything, and you can just connect to them using your account number. And of course, there are others like TunnelBear and ProtonVPN. Firefox VPN, I believe, they just resell Malvat. I don't know how you pronounce this, but yeah. And okay, here, okay, maybe wondering why I actually list the jurisdiction that they are based in, right? Because it sort of matters, because, again, it depends on your threat model. So who exactly are you protecting yourself against, right? So if you're protecting yourself against the United States, then maybe you wouldn't want to use a VPN provider that is located in the Five Eyes, right? And you can look at this VPN comparison table to look at other things that you might care about. So like whether they log, or whether they are in the Five Eyes or 14 Eyes, or they are, you know, so on and so forth. Yeah, all of these things are really based on your threat model. Yes. So that is VPN services. And you can, of course, run your own VPN. So I do not recommend running OpenVPN anymore. WireGuard is a lot simpler to use and it usually suffices for most use cases. So if you want to set up your own VPN, you can just check out the Arch Wiki as usual. I personally use this, so I have a WireGuard server running like a basically on a Odroid C2 connected to my router. And so if I need to VPN somewhere, or usually I use a VPN as a way to bypass like firewalls from like corporate networks or like basically NUS firewalls, right? Because NUS likes to block a lot of things for no reason. So I use it to VPN to my home connection where I can then connect to whatever I need to connect to, right? I mean, I also use it to be able to connect to my computer over the internet, because I don't want my computer to be exposed directly, so I expose my VPN instead, right? Yeah, that's the actual, I would say that's the initial use of a VPN. That's why it's called a virtual private network, right? Because you're creating a virtual network of computers that are not actually in the same private network. Is Tor more secure than VPN? I would say yes and no. Tor is an onion network. Basically, what Tor does is it will route your connections through... they sort of do different things. So if you're connected to Tor, then all your connections will be routed through a bunch of relays and stuff, and they'll come out somewhere else in the internet. It's not exactly related to VPN. You can use them for similar purposes, but they are rather different, I would say. Like VPN just means that you connect to some provider or some server, and all your connections will be routed through that server and then out to the internet, right? Tor is like you are connected to the Tor network, and your connections will be, will be sent into the network and then routed through the network. And through a bunch of relays and stuff and come out somewhere else. And the point is to make it sort of difficult for someone to actually tell where exactly the original connection came from, right? That's the point of the Tor network. So Tor is, I would say, more focused on privacy and anonymity, right? Rather than it all plays together, but Tor has sort of a different aim in mind. It does a different thing. Yeah. Okay. We are almost at the end. Messengers. So these are some sort of messengers that are sort of encrypted. Telegram is not encrypted, I would say. I mean, the protocol between your client and the server is encrypted, but it's not end-to-end encrypted, right? These three are end-to-end encrypted. So Signal is sort of trusted by people like whistleblowers and people who need privacy use Signal. Element or Matrix, right? Matrix is a protocol for TED, right? It's a new open and federated protocol. So what federated means is that what federated means is that you can write your own servers and you can run your own servers and they can all and write your own clients and they can all interoperate and work together, right, in a network, right? So that's a good thing. The Matrix protocol is trusted as well, and a lot of people, especially people in the open source community are moving towards hosting their own Matrix instances for chat. Instead of using things like Discord or Slack or whatever, because those are all centralized, right? Matrix is something you run by yourself, so you are responsible for it yourself, so like you don't have to trust someone else with all your chats and things like that. But if you're talking about instant messaging, then there's Signal, there's WhatsApp. These two use the same. So Signal has its own protocol, and then like WhatsApp supposedly uses the Signal protocol, but it's closed source. But I would imagine that since so many people use WhatsApp, if it were actually spying on people, then someone will actually find out eventually. And then there's also Telegram, which they like to talk about their encryption, but honestly, their encryption is kind of questionable. Like no one really knows why they decided to roll their own encryption for no reason. But I think a lot of people just use Telegram just because it is convenient, Yeah. And there are a lot of other messengers, but most of them offer no privacy or security at all. So like Line, KakaoTalk. What else is there? Facebook Messenger, Instagram DM. all these are not WeChat, what else is there? QQ and all those. Yeah, all these are not they offer no privacy like, because they're all centralized and like yeah. So if you care about your privacy, use Signal, use Matrix or potentially WhatsApp. Yeah, so if you want to see more privacy-focused alternatives to common software, you can look at this website. So they offer you alternatives to a lot of things, like email, search, web hosting, and so on. Cloud storage, right? And if you really care about your privacy or you don't want to rely on Google, you should stop using Google. You can look at like DuckDuckGo, switch to DuckDuckGo for your searches, switch to a different email provider. You know, host your own email and things, so on and so forth. Yeah, but again, back to what I showed at the start, it's really, up to your threat model and up to what you want to protect yourself against. Yes. And finally, another XKCD comic. So this is basically talking about how, the desktop or the PC security model is kind of weird lah, because like you need sudo to like install things via a package manager, right? People steal your laptop, they don't know your password, so they cannot install things or install drivers, but they can just open your web browser and access all these things, right? So it's kind of weird, the security model, and which is why I say nowadays PCs are not safe. Mobile phones nowadays are better isolated, right? So on a PC, any program you download can access the files of any other program you have, right? And like right now, there is some work being done to sort of isolate that. So on Linux, there's like Flatpak and Snap, and they provide some sort of sandboxing. On Windows, they have the Windows Store apps, so like those Unified Windows platform or something like that. So those are supposed to be sandboxed a bit, and I don't know what Mac has lah. Yeah, but on mobile phones, so like Android and iPhone, you know, since the start, right, all apps are sort of isolated from each other. So each app cannot access the files of another app, right? So they're much better isolated lah. And I think this is important lah nowadays when you have a lot of things on your computer, right? And if you just download one malicious app, then all your files are potentially lost lah. Or when I say lost, I mean like open to the attacker to access. Yep. So exposed, right? Exposed. Compromised. So yeah, that's the end of the content for this workshop. I know it's not a very interactive workshop. It's mostly just sharing about the different things you can do, the different alternatives you can look at, how you can sort of improve your online privacy, improve your online security, and also of course the tips and tricks I mentioned regarding web and the different things you can do lah. So again, I would say you can look through the slides again and then look through like decide on what changes you want to make to improve your security or privacy and things like that, and then make those changes, and then you see how it goes on lah. And periodically just evaluate your current setup and decide if you want to make more changes, kind of thing. Yes. So thank you. Please fill in the feedback. So see you for the next see you for the next Hacker Tool session, which will be more interactive. It will be the session is on CLI debugging and profiling, right? It's more of a Linux focused workshop, right? So if you're interested in learning how to debug and profile Linux systems as well as programs on Linux, right? I will talk about I'll talk about certain other things as well, like Python, so which is more independent, but it'll be mostly focused on Linux. So that is in 2 weeks. The sign up link should have been sent out at 8 p.m. on our Telegram channel, right? So you can go look out for that. The Facebook event has been up. I think the meetup event is also up. Okay, let me answer Alvin's question. I know you're still here. I'm looking for your question. When you install any flavor of Linux, they ask if you want to encrypt your hard disk. How do you log in? And then what are the cases it protects? So, when you install Linux, okay, so when you use full disk encryption, right, this sort of applies to any, regardless of your OS, lah. Basically, full disk encryption can be done in, I would say, mainly two ways. The first way is to use some sort of password or key or something like that, which you need to key in or have plugged into your computer when you boot, right? So like, you can have a password that you need to type in every time you start your computer, or you can have like a key dongle which contains a key file. So you need that key file to be plugged into your computer whenever you boot your computer, so that it will get the key from the dongle or whatever it is, and then unlock your hard drive, right? The other way is to have the key stored in a trusted platform module, right? TPM. That is basically a module that will that I think many computers have nowadays. Many, if not most, computers. Most if not all computers have nowadays. So if you have the TPM or if you have the key put into a TPM, then the TPM will basically check that your system is not been tampered with, right? So basically, it will check that your system has not been tampered with. So like, for example, when I say tamper, I mean like, for example, the attacker can say, put a, some program to sort of intercept the key and then extract the key so that they can later on access the information, right? So the TPM will check that the system hasn't been tampered with and like it's booting the real OS, right? So then it will pass the key to the OS to unlock or your bootloader to unlock your OS your drive, right? Yeah, and then from there it basically you're relying on the OS security being the OS being secure so that they can't somehow log in as yourself without knowing a password. Basically, full disk encryption is to protect against people. Basically, if they get your laptop, right, or your PC, they can take out the hard drive and then access the files, right? So basically, you encrypt the files, right? You encrypt the files to prevent people from being able to taking out the drive and reading the files. So then there are two ways. So when you encrypt, then you need to have somewhere to store the key or password lah. Basically mount your hard drive onto another computer and just access all your files, right? So you encrypt your hard drive to stop that, and then when you encrypt it, you need your password to be stored somewhere. So it's either you just key in the password every time you boot up, or the second way is to have it in your trusted platform module TPM, and the TPM will basically verify that the TPM only release it to the sort of authorized software lah. So then that sort of solves the problem lah. Yeah, it still doesn't protect your data against a $5 wrench lah, because that's a human problem now. So ultimately the problem is still the human lah. You can make everything theoretically, and I mean you can make everything secure in the computational sense, but doesn't protect it doesn't solve the human problem. Cheng Yi. Okay. I will read your question out because I think it will it can be beneficial to whoever is here lah. I'm trying to install VeraCrypt and I noticed there is a portable version. May I know what is the difference between the portable version and the installer? As far as I know, they are the same. It's just whether they install it onto your, what you call that? They install into your system so you have like start menu entries and all or not. Basically, I would say you use the portable version if like you are creating an encrypted container on the thumb drive, right? And like, you know, if you bring the thumb drive to another computer, then, you know, if you don't have, then I will use the portable version and put it onto the thumb drive so that if the computer doesn't have VeraCrypt installed, I can still unlock the drive, you know. I just use the portable version of VeraCrypt on the thumb drive itself. Otherwise, I will say there's not much difference. Yeah, basically that's it. And of course, the installer version will save the settings and stuff into your computer. The portable version will save any settings to wherever it is placed. Yeah, this is probably standard for most portable versus non or normal apps. Like a lot of, especially Windows, a lot of Windows programs have some sort of portable version, right? Just because of the way Windows works, where you have to install things into C program files, you know, and then like all the settings files are like strewn everywhere over your file system, like registry or your application data, things like that, right? But that's just how Windows is.